And we're going to get underway now with our next discussion. And it's very exciting to have these three guests with us. We are very soon going to open up the floor to your questions and comments. So be ready with your questions for our esteemed panelists. Let me introduce the CEOs of Bruce Power, OPG, and New Brunswick Power to you. Mike Rencheck, Jeff Lyash, and Gaetan Thomas. Welcome to all of you. Great to have you here. I think I'm not going to read your bios because I think everybody knows who you are and knows your organizations well. So let's get right into this. And Jeff, maybe you can start because there's some exciting news to share.
Yeah, certainly. Well, we're certainly excited at OPG about the future of nuclear and in Canada, in the world, and in the province of Ontario. Very pleased to let everyone know that our Unit 2 refurbishment is going extremely well. We're almost 60% through the first unit, and as of this morning, we're 17 days out of schedule. And we intend to finish that way, safely, at the level of quality that we all know is necessary, on budget, and on or ahead of schedule. And I think this is a substantial proof that nuclear can execute and can deliver some of the vision that was discussed this morning. But the news I'd like to make sure everybody knows is we reached a point in the Unit 2 execution and the preparedness process for Unit 3 refurbishment. And just in the past few weeks, we met with the provincial government, the Treasury Board, the Cabinet to review the progress on Unit 2 and received approval to proceed with Unit 3. So we were off and running with the Unit 3 refurbishment. And the credit to that certainly sits with the OPG staff, but also with every one of you in the room who are part of this supply chain, part of this nuclear community, without whose support we couldn't do this.
Okay, great. And I know that it's a big deal to have, of course, you and Mike on the stage together, and you guys are even dressed very similarly today, I noticed, with the red ties, but also the socks. You've got the socks down pat, which is good.
Cabal 60 socks.
Yeah. We'll have to get you some, Gaetan.
I think we can fix this.
Yeah.
So this spirit of we're in this together, Mike, maybe you can speak a little bit about that and what it means.
Yeah, you know, it's a great industry to be in, and we learn so much from each other all the time. Gardington benefited from our Unit 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 experiences. And I can't tell you how much we appreciate the collaboration we have with Jeff and his team. We're garnering so much information about all the details that are ongoing with the construction down at Darlington. It's helping our planning efforts. We're looking at items that we wouldn't even consider, like residential rust or dirt that fall off a tube when you pull it out. You think about that, it's that level of thinking and that level of detail that you can only see firsthand with experience. And that experience matters, right? We can talk a lot about how to go about doing this in theory, but when you actually get your hands on it and have to do it, it makes a difference. That collaboration is the same way, right? We as an industry can work very resoundingly together to move forward nuclear energy, and we can do that by working with each other. But what that means is we have to get our hands dirty. We have to participate. It's an active dialogue. It's an active effort that each of us can contribute to move forward. And our collaboration between the companies, including New Brunswick Power, right? Point La Proe was a big adder to all that as well. They were the first, right? They were the first to garner the details and garner the information, and they passed it on to Bruce and passed it on to OPG. And passed it on to Argentina, and passed it on to others around the world. And that collaboration, I think, is infectious in this industry that we find ourselves in. And that's one of the joy of working in nuclear power. It's an industry like no other, right? We tend to share things in other industries that just would not be shared. So I can't tell you, Jeff, how happy we are to have this collaboration going. You know, we have a joint staff meeting every 2 weeks where my direct reports and Jeff direct reports, we talk about a number of things, anywhere from engineering to the refurbishments that are underway to how we get people processed through security clearances quicker, faster, easier. It's quite the collaboration. It's taken on a whole other dimension now, and I'm positive that as we prepare for our Unit 6 major component replacement, this collaboration will set us up for success, not only in the near term, but in the future. And it'll set the bedrock for the next generation of reactors, like small modular reactors, that we'll be able to build when we do these refurbishments on time and on budget.
I couldn't agree more, Mike. You talk about getting your hands dirty and the collaboration between the two companies. I was out at Darlington about two or three Sundays ago to watch the operation that we had underway removing pressure tubes. And I was in the Project Control Center, which is where boilermakers, instead of carrying tool bags, are operating robotic equipment remotely to exercise this very high-tech operation. And the shift supervisor who was running that operation on that day is a Bruce employee on loan, seconded to OPG, who's actually executing the tasks at Brunswick and can carry that firsthand experience back to the Bruce refurb.
It doesn't get any better than that, right? Sharing firsthand knowledge, firsthand experience. It makes all the difference when you actually have to go do it, right? I always used to say, it's one thing to talk about it, it's another to do it. And that firsthand learning, that firsthand experience will help us not only in the near term, but in the long term.
Great. All right, Gaetan, let's hear from you.
Well,
let's get an update from you.
I have to say that it's such a joy to be here between these two fantastic guys, because I've been between these two guys, predecessors before, and it wasn't as smooth as it is today. So I have to say, you know, I give them credit. One of the things that I think this industry was known for in the past is maybe we had a little too much ego. And it's okay to want to control the world, but in order to get a Canadian advantage, a Canadian future on new technology, next generation, I really believe that we can only do it together. And in New Brunswick, because we are so small, we always depended on Bruce and OPG. And Mike talked about the importance, gets their hands dirty. Well, there was quite a few Bruce secondees, and especially OPG, our plant manager, our project director, Mike Allen. I mean, he's doing well in Darlington, but he got his hands real dirty in Point La Pro. So there's a lot of learning, and to be successful, to have credibility, we need something on time and on budget. And credit to the OPG staff for getting us there, like that hope that we can deliver. And for us in New Brunswick, we're just too small. We cannot do it by ourselves. We're working closely with OPG and Bruce, and I'm grateful to have these guys. I'm honored to be here between the two of you guys, and congratulations for making it easier for the small guy.
That's great. Would any of you like to sing, by the way?
Is there any? It's on. Yeah.
We might, but you wouldn't enjoy it.
We reserved that for the last segment where you want to clear the room.
Okay. All right, so I know the one key area of the industry is the supply chain, and maybe you can discuss some of the positive things you've seen and some of the challenges the industry is facing there. Do you want to start, Mike?
Yeah, you know, we have one of the greatest supply chains in the world here in Canada. It is a Canadian gem. It's probably one of the only places in the world where we can still build just about everything that goes into the reactor without outside influence. Think about the power of an industry that can do that in today's space. And not only do it, but do it well and do it cost effectively. And I say cost effectively, when you look at the power in Ontario, right, from the Ontario Energy Board, solar is 48 cents a kilowatt hour, gas is around 17 cents a kilowatt hour, wind's about 14 cents a kilowatt hour, and nuclear is 6.6 cents per kilowatt hour, hydro 5.8 cents. So it's a low-cost source of electricity. It supplies 60% of the energy in Ontario. And when you look at the long-term future of it, we talked a little bit about the cost, right, of nuclear. With the investments that we're making in our plant, the Financial Accountability Office for the government of Ontario says we'll be about 8 cents when it's all said and done. Think about that, 8-cent power for 60 years. Who can plan a business around that? The economic might it can be established in Ontario from stable, long-term electricity sources. The transformation of the transportation sector to cleaner energy forms can be done, and all this without emissions, without CO2, without carbon. It's a great prospect. Our supply chain is able to deliver this. It's a great prospect.
Yeah, Jeff, did you want to jump in?
I agree. So I've been engaged in operating and building nuclear plants around the world for a long time. I've never seen a supply chain this capable. And I got to tell you, it is a big part of Canada's nuclear advantage. I'll often say that on our refurbishment, the $12.8 billion we're spending and investing in these plants, 96% of that, 96 cents out of every dollar, gets spent with Canadian businesses, largely in Ontario. And the reason that happens isn't because we're forcing that money into businesses that aren't ready to deliver. It's because this supply chain exists. It exists at a very high level of performance, very high level of quality. And that money just lives multiple lifetimes in the economy. The economic impact, the impact to GDP as a result of this is tremendous. Over the life of Darlington, it's $90 billion of GDP. I don't know what you think is a big number, but I bet you $90 billion is more than that. It really is tremendous. And the last, just a link to innovation I'd make here is we as owners count on the supply chain to be constantly innovating, to lower the cost of the goods and services delivered so that we can pass that lower cost to our customers and lower more stable electricity prices, to find technological innovations that improve safety, improve quality, increase production. And this supply chain is extremely well positioned to do that because you're not fighting the battles of figuring out how to do the business right. You're doing it right. Now you can turn your attention to innovation and how to do it better.
And this is an area that I would challenge you to work together on, right? Through collaboration, all things are possible. By working together, we can do new and creative things. So I encourage the suppliers where you're looking or you have an idea and you don't have all the technology, instead of trying to invent it yourself, work with your peers. It's a fantastic group of organizations, fantastic group of people in this industry. Somewhere along the way, we can figure it out. We have the technology and we can innovate and create the next new idea that will help our plants run better, safer, longer, less expensively.
And when you think about what this does for this country, you know, we're already one of the lowest cost producer in the world, average of 8.5 cents a kilowatt hour throughout the country. Impossible without the big nuclear influence in Ontario. We're looking at our emissions. We're 80% non-emitting today. We have the potential with this nuclear innovation that Jeff and Mike talks about to actually get 100% or close to 100% non-emitting. I mean, there would be no other country that could do that. And we do it without bankrupting the country. Like, there are people like California and Germany who have tried to do it, but what we're finding out, like if you look, the statistics in Ontario are pretty amazing. You know, a quarter of the emissions in Ontario from California at nearly half the cost. And if you go to Germany, it's a tenth of the emission at a third or, you know, close to a 2.5 less cost. So this country has it all. And the end, because nuclear has so much power, so much energy, lesser footprint, the fuel is people, is the people in this room. And I can tell you that the 1,000 best job in St. John are working at a Point Le Pro. And that's incredible for the economy in New Brunswick. So the impact is that you get low emission, you get innovation up the yin-yang, and you have a low-cost product.
That's a technical term, by the way.
That's a highly technical term.
You know, and you have a low cost. I mean, this is really a dream for a country like ours that could actually, with a seventh of the surface of the world, with only 30 million people, we're well positioned. And we got to take advantage of it. And I think we're appealing to the 800 people here to actually help us propagate that message. It's incredibly powerful for this country.
Yeah, let me, Gaetan cited some really interesting statistics that were worth repeating. You should know them. Think about what Mike said about the relative prices of sources of electricity for our economy. In Germany, Even with all the wind and solar they've deployed, the carbon intensity of a kilowatt hour of electricity produced is 560 grams. 560 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour. And the price is 45 cents for that electricity. In California, it's 240 grams per kilowatt hour, and it's 25 cents. In Ontario, it's 40 grams, 40, and it's 16 cents. Think about those numbers. And why? It's because Ontario is 61 today. It's 61% of the energy coming from nuclear, 30% coming from hydro. It's 91%. About 5% from gas, and about 4% from all of the wind and solar deployed across the province. Ontario's performance is built on the back of nuclear and hydro. And that same model can serve all of Canada extremely well in driving for the 2030 and 2050 climate change goals.
You know, and we don't just talk about electricity. With nuclear, you get a lot of other things with it. One of the things we wanted to chat some was about isotopes, and we have a little video that we wanted to show. So can we cue that up?
When I was five, I had no idea what cancer was. They sat us down in a room and said to my mom, "Your child has a grade 3 anaplastic ependymoma."
You, of course, at first don't believe that it's actually happening to your child. She had known that my mother had passed away from cancer.
I never knew what was about to unfold before me. I've had surgery, radiation, chemo. Usually with a regular surgery, I'm in like maybe 2 days. But I was home that afternoon when I had gamma knife. I told everyone I wanted to rename it the Magic Rainbow Beam because they're just beams going into your head and it makes cancer go away. So it's really cool that we have technology nowadays that can do that.
See, I get a little choked up when I watch that. We had Jalen come and speak to our leadership team. Because it's more than about making electricity with nuclear. It becomes personal. Jalen is a beneficiary of cobalt-60 that are made in our nuclear power plants here in Canada. You may or may not know, but through a little company in Ottawa called Nordion, we dominate the world market in cobalt-60 isotopes. The high specific activity cobalt-60 is used to treat brain tumors, and it's used in a technology developed in London, Ontario. And quite frankly, it was in jeopardy of not being available to people like Jalen. When Chalk River's NRU reactor came to end of life and began to close down, and actually closing this year, there would have been a worldwide shortage of this isotope. So when you meet Jalen, it becomes very personal. Here's a child at age 6, started cancer treatments for brain tumors, and had spent months in the hospital. After treatments, months trying to recover from the treatments. With cobalt-60, she can go in for the treatment and go back home again and live a life as a little girl. That puts a personal face on the innovations and the types of things that we're able to do with this technology. And it's a very subtle item that can get overlooked in policies. It can get overlooked by politicians, by people that don't understand, and if we don't explain this portion of our business well enough, it can leave people like Jalen without a resource that they can use to get well. And in our business, we can make it at a high enough scale where the unit cost is low enough that it becomes an affordable treatment. See, we're making it in mass at our plants, at Bruce, at OPG. How many folks in the room have ever had surgery? You may or may not know that 40% of all the once-used medical equipment in operating rooms is sterilized by Cobalt-60 made here in Canada. So no matter where you are in the world, chances are one of us, the Canadian presence, is in that room with you making sure that your surgery goes okay from the very beginning. And I think this is an aspect of our business that really ingrains the people that work in the industry. It's more than just about making electricity. Sometimes electricity is taken for granted, right? You walk out, all the lights are on. It's just there all the time. But it's these types of ancillary products that really make a difference in society that you can't get from other technologies. They're not capable of producing these things in their processes. They don't have the energy densities. So I think as an industry, these innovations for us, I think Cobalt-60 is an example, is just the beginning. I think there are innovations that we can do in our plans to become a larger player in the medical community. And I think embracing the medical community and extending our offerings to other industries and other entities will only help us to progress into the future.
Wow, that's very powerful stuff. Thank you, Mike. Jeff, you touched on wind and solar a couple of minutes ago, representing 4% of the power generation in Ontario, and I know that a lot of people sort of see that as innovative and the future of electricity generation, but at the same time, nuclear power is sometimes seen as old-fashioned technology, and I know you have some thoughts on that, that image challenge and what we can do to overcome it.
Yeah, it's remarkable to me. It's a bit confusing. You heard earlier, for some reason, the public at large views nuclear technology as some old school technology, not innovated, stuck in some distant past or generation, a thing of the past that's going to phase out. And they think of technologies like wind and solar as somehow cutting edge. I mean, what technology is older than a windmill? Really? Any of you know how windmills work? I'm betting you do. So I think wind and solar play a very important role. I mean, we're building a solar installation on the coal, where the coal pile used to be at our Nanticoke facility. So for OPG, we're not opposed to wind and solar. I think they're good resources. They're just not high tech. They're just not highly innovative. When you take a look at what's going on in the nuclear industry, Mike talked about radioisotope in production. Let me just give you a few other examples. So for me, when I think about innovation, you can certainly think about basic science and research, neutrinos and their impacts. Very, very important. But for most of us, I think innovation is about taking two great things and putting them together in a new way that produces a new result. That's most of what the innovation I see happening revolves around. And I can take a walk through one of our facilities, and in an afternoon, I'll see our training organization deploying virtual reality in the training environment to better qualify and evaluate the workforce. I'll go in the plant and see people with Google glasses on who can call up information, reference material, data on the equipment they're working on so that that's right at their fingertips. I can go to the X Lab and see us printing a 3D component on a 3D printer, printing a component that is obsolete, but we can reverse engineer and fabricate ourselves and put into use in the field. As I said, we're taking apart these reactors with robotic equipment, with laser alignment, and high precision machining that is state of the art. So innovation is nuclear. That's what we do. That's what we've always done. And I think we need to keep doing that. And I'd like to make one more point about innovation, because this morning's panel, as we talked about how we have to engage the public, re-educate, refocus, rebrand this industry if we're going to help solve some of the world's biggest problems, That's innovation too. Innovation is, taking two great things, putting them together in a different way. So innovation is Bruce and OPG and NB Power collaborating to turn refurbs out in ways that we've never seen before in terms of success. It's more than that. It's the owners collaborating with the suppliers to drive innovation that lowers costs, improves safety and output. It's the suppliers collaborating with communities to make sure that communities understand the economic impact, the environmental impact, and the impact on their power prices of what those suppliers are doing in that local town. It's communities collaborating with policymakers, government officials, like Kim Rudd that we heard this morning. Because if that's innovation, because if we can find new ways to do that more effectively, then what results is an industry and a society that is aligned around what it really takes to solve the problems that are in front of us. So, you know, I love wind, I love solar. Man, nuclear is where it's at.
Okay.
Now, you have a video as well that is about clean air, clean energy, right?
Yeah,
you want to share that now?
Let's cue this up. So, you know, over the period of a number of years, Ontario retired all its coal as we brought the Bruce units back, took Pickering Darlington to a higher level of performance, optimized our hydro fleet, and it has made a huge difference in the air in Ontario. Certainly greenhouse gas, but NOx, SOx, smog, et cetera. And so we try to reach out and help people realize what's happened here. So cue up the video. It's a little bit of fun.
Hey guys, wanna come on over and smell some air? Hi there, come on over. So what I'm doing here is actually just letting people sample some air. So this is from Algonquin Provincial Park. It's an amazing place, and the air there is like some of the best air you're gonna get. This is Killarney Provincial Park. This one is from last spring. That's when it was bottled. Yeah, here, go ahead and have a smell of that. This is air from the top of Ontario, so you really wanna...
Wait, what?
This is a Rouge Urban Park. There's a note of pine. Good, because this is a 2014 vintage, and that's the year we closed our last coal burning plant.
Oh.
Yeah, this is the one. There might be notes of pear. Oh, it's like you can almost smell the call of the loons.
Oh, it smells clean and fresh. There's nothing in it.
There's nothing in it, right? What do you smell? Air, yeah. This is a smart kid. I'm just gonna fill it up again, okay?
There we go.
The air's in here, yeah. Well, it's everywhere.
This is a joke, right?
There's nothing funny about clean air. Do you know why it's so clean? Because the power that we generate is 99% free of carbon and smog emissions.
Wow.
I know. Breathe it in. What do you smell? Keep breathing, guys. Keep breathing.
That's great.
That's good.
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about the future of nuclear in Canada. And Gaetan, maybe we can start with you on that, where this is going. And is it about large facilities? Is it about SMRs? Is it a combination?
Well, it could be a combination, but for the smaller markets like New Brunswick, and we have a big issue in the region, because we have between Nova Scotia and New Brunswick, we have close to 2,000 megawatts of coal that we have to phase out. Only one left in New Brunswick, but a lot in our neighbors. And we believe that the solution is in the small modular reactors. You know, we are doing a lot of research right now where we have a lot of people that are interested, because we have a perfectly situated site at Point Lepreau. It has some pre-environmental approval, and we have, you know, obviously the staff, and we also are very close to a market that needs it, okay? And we believe that with some work, and we will need the collaboration from my colleagues here, because by ourselves, We cannot take on the R&D involved or the first of a kind type of risk. But we are willing to be innovative, we're willing to lead it, we're willing to open the door. We have a wonderful social acceptance. So for us, it's likely to be a small modular reactor, and we would like to have one in built in New Brunswick by 2028. And we got to start now. Like, it takes a while to get, you know, design certification. I know Dr. Binder is telling me yesterday, bring your application in. You know, we're ready for you. So I said, next time I go, I bring an application in, because one of my minister came, and he never forgets, you know, that Dr. Binder has a memory, and he says, you know, we were giving him a hard time about a new reactor. He said, well, where's your application, minister? And so we're going to come with one, and we think that the modularity and also dealing with some of, you know, a burner would be favorable for us, because, you know, we want to deal with some of the waste and reduce the hundreds of thousands of years. If, you know, if we can get that to a, down to a 300 year, like, I think we'll be able to manage the environmental issues better with small modular reactors in the future. Not that the ones we have now are, you know, they're very safe, but the issue becomes, if you're going to scale it up and you're going to go in provinces that don't have nuclear, like Nova Scotia, Alberta, Saskatchewan, I think that it goes with SMRs, and there's all kinds of interest. I know we have a dozen in the country. I see Mark here. We have a wonderful research center in Chalk River, and collaborating with the three utilities in Chalk River. I believe with 100%, close to 100% supply chain in this country, we could have a solution not only for Canada, but the whole world. So I'm excited about it, and I want to be part of it. And I don't have a video, okay, to present. Okay. It's a little impromptu. But I could do an Acadian tap.
You're not going to sing, could, and you don't you have a
dance.
Video.
I could do an Acadian tap dance, but Kathleen won't allow me. So we'll bring a video next year.
Okay. Mike, your thoughts on where the industry is going?
Yeah, you know, I think the industry is all about the people. And it's been about the technology historically. And I think, you know, Jeff and I were chatting a little bit earlier about why did we get into the industry, right? The industry has always had great people. It's one of the safest industries you can work in. So when you talk about safety all the time, the question is, why are we even talking about it? I agree with what you said earlier. It's one of the safest industries, if not the safest industry in the world. You're more likely to get hurt on Bay Street than you are in one of our plants, right? It's just not something that is there. We can't take it for granted. We always have to look after it. But it's ingrained in our culture. And so I think as we look at the next generation and the future, Gaetan has a vision, right? He has a vision for where we as an industry can move to. So what takes us there? It's the people. It's the people. When you look at the industry, there was a lot of hiring, and then it hit a downslope for a while, right? After Three Mile Island and other industries, and basically hiring stopped. So somewhere between the age of 40 and maybe 55-ish, there's a gap of people there. There are some folks in that age in the group, but a lot of the folks coming in are all under the age of 35. So you sit there and you say, what an industry. If you sit and think about it, and you look and you think, what do you want to do when you grow up? You can do all these things in this industry. You can be an activist. You can be an advocate. You can work with technologies. You can work with healthcare products. You can be an environmentalist, probably foremost an environmentalist. You can create things that people need every day. You can make products. The innovation potential is there for whatever we set our mind to do. And the collaboration in the industry is key to seeing a vision like Gaetan put forward turn into reality. And only the people of the organizations can make that happen. You know, Jeff talked a lot about collaboration earlier. But that's how things get done in society. It's not so much the technology. There's lots of technologies. But it's the people working together to really drive forward that vision and turning it into something real. And that requires, again, getting our hands dirty. That means we have to actively engage and actively participate to the best of our abilities. And that's the beauty about having so many great people. If you don't know something, all you have to do is say, I don't know this, and chances are there's somebody in the room that can help.
Okay, we're going to talk more about people in a moment, but Jeff, did you want to talk a little more about the direction that we're going?
I just wanted to make a comment, share a thought with you. What struck me this morning, as I think about the future of the nuclear industry, is the excitement and the passion and the interest of the folks who spoke this morning and of the students and the young generation that are engaging in this industry now. That's where the future is, right? So you all realize that, those of you who are earlier in your career in this industry. I'm really not sure when Mike and Gaetan and I became the old generation in nuclear. because we used to be the young generation in nuclear. And I would share with you that I think, certainly I did, and I would guess it's true for everybody here on the stage, I got into this business for the same reason you're getting into it. So, when I was trying to decide what to do with my career, I asked my grandmother what she thought, and she told me two things that really stuck with me. One was, you should do something important, something that makes a difference in the lives of people, and you should do something very, very difficult that requires you to apply all your talents, because that's really why God put you here. And so I looked at that, and my choice was the electricity sector and ultimately the nuclear sector, because electricity is what raises people out of poverty, and nuclear, because I think it's a technology that can deliver that without destroying the planet. That's why I entered the field that I'm in. Not randomly, not by accident. My guess is you're entering it for the same reason. And hopefully together with your energy and our experience, we can create the future of nuclear here in Canada.
So what advice would each of you give to the new generation of employees in the industry, people who are looking at a career in nuclear? Gaetan?
Well, look, I grew up in a farm near a windmill in 1960. I'm just 32. But in that farm, in that windmill, I saw some hope in electricity. And I'm one of those that actually nuclear became a second career for me. I think I got out of be able to be challenged or innovative, and then they gave me this big refurbishment at Point La Pro, which I got my hands real dirty. But after learning about it and sitting on the world board now of WANO and realizing that when I travel, I'm more exposed to radiation than in my nuclear plant. When I go to the dentist, I'm more exposed to radiation than my nuclear plant. And I'm like Mike just said, I'm safest. The place where I won't get hurt is in my nuclear plant. They won't let me touch anything. and I won't get hurt, right? It's the safest place in the world. And we have an issue. So the young people, when I look at how I've been able to grow in a career, and it's a bit by accident because the refurbishment, my project experience, they asked me to go there. But I never realized how much innovation, how much purpose, and how much collaboration. Since I've been in nuclear, I signed every email, together, everyone achieves more, which is the four acronym for team. You cannot do this thing without people. People is our fuel, and you have to be extremely innovative in those relationships. The psychometrics, the how to get people in the right slots, and there's really so many job descriptions, so many things. Most of them I can't do, and that's why I think this is what we're missing here. Is we need to sell that it's a career, and people like Jeff and Brett Plummer that works for me and Mike that have been 40 years in a career, I can see they don't want to retire. They want to continue, and I don't know if it's the glowing, I don't know if it's the
it's a cobalt salt.
Cobalt.
Yeah.
it's low level of radiation, very low level. It's supposed to be good for you. I'm telling you, it changed my whole purpose in life. And I think one of the things that we haven't sold enough, I will repeat it, it is one of the most innovative technology, which requires innovative leadership, and Mike appealing to the public and how we connect with people through radiation treatment. In my view, that this air in Ontario would be completely different. I've been in Beijing, I've been in Shenzhen, and I'm telling you, it's not like being in Toronto. So we've got the solution. So young people in this room, and I see they're all kind of my age, or we got to get more young people. It's as simple as that. It's one of the best career, and I think you'll live longer with it because you love, it's a purpose. There's a purpose. Your grandma talked about purpose. There's a purpose in this industry. You know, we are we're saving the planet. We're helping people with medical issues. My mother has cancer, and I sit on a board for research of cancer. And again, it is my nuclear affiliation that has grown my horizon to be on a world board of a fantastic technology that will save the world if the world wants to listen.
Okay, great. Mike?
I think when you look at our demographics, at least at Bruce Power, roughly 35% of our folks are under the age of 35. So the advice that I would give you is don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to get involved. Don't be afraid to try something new. Are there going to be mistakes? Yes. Are some of the things you do going to not work out? Yes. But if you don't try new things, you don't work to do new things, right? Those experiences are how you grow and how you prosper. So the advice I would give the new generation coming in is ask for more, right? Don't wait. Be impatient. Keep asking until someone listens. And you know, we heard this morning, maybe we do need to do a better job of listening more. So the older folks in the room, heads up, right? Get your hearing aids out. I have mine, right? Better job of listening. But the younger generation, keep asking questions. Keep questioning why. The paradigm has to change. And you're the motive force for change.
Okay. Jeff, we're going to go to you in a second. I'm just going to let people know that right after Jeff's comments, we're going to open it up to all of you for your thoughts and your questions. So we'll get microphones around. So think of what you want to say or ask and to join this discussion. Jeff?
Yeah, I'd just add one thing. I think that the challenge for everyone sitting in this room is clear. We have an amazing technology. We have huge amounts of innovation going on. This technology can evolve generation after generation into new reactor designs, new applications that can be impactful for Canada, that can be impactful for the planet. But no one out there is going to know it if we talk amongst ourselves. Or if when we face the outside world, we're not aligned, we're not synchronized in our messaging. We're not synchronized in our efforts. And I'm not talking about being synchronized like the synchronized swimming scene from Caddyshack. I'm sort of talking about synchronized like Virtue and Moyer that won the gold medal the other night in ice dancing, right? Maybe without the tight-fitting clothing, Mike. But that kind of precise synchronization where we're sending all the same messages, we're pulling all in the same direction, whether it's on refurbishment or the extension of Pickering's life or the deployment of SMRs or the development of our supply chain into a global power.
Okay, great. All right, let's open it up to you. Just put your hand up if you have a question. We've got one over here and one right here. So let's get some microphones over to you. Go ahead.
In the spirit of not being afraid to ask questions. So my name is John Rolston. I'm with Ontario Power Generation. So we're talking a lot about the future of nuclear in Canada and the world, and because of its effects on climate change. And, you know, I heard Jeff say You know, we're trying to do a lot to be innovative on how we deal with public perception. So, you know, I think we've seen a lot of good examples of how we're already doing that. Great work, by the way, some of the videos we saw today. But what about the electric car revolution? And I think the electric car revolution is a lot closer around the corner than most of us in this room realize. And, you know, in the spirit of being authors of our own destiny, so to speak, why don't we try to get more people driving electric cars? Thank you.
Okay.
We are. In New Brunswick, as an integrated utility, and I know that my colleagues are also members of the Plug and Drive organization, but we are promoting electric vehicles. And last year in New Brunswick, we had the highest increase year over year percentage in the country because we were able to get federal support to have a electric vehicle fast charging station all around the province. 19 will have been done all around this our beautiful province. And we know that, again, the load will increase when that technology advances. And it's not 10 years away. It's more like 5-6 years away. And so we at NB Power are right ahead of it, leading the country in terms of a provincial distributed fast charging station. And we do believe that to address the emission issues we have in New Brunswick, 30% are transportation. I would say it's similar to that for the rest of the country, which means we can only solve by more electric vehicles, which means more nuclear will be required.
You know, at Plug and Drive, Ontario is one of the only places in the world where you can go into a location and test drive any number. I think there's about 10 electric vehicles there. So it's not just a demonstration station. So if you have an interest in electric vehicle, you can go there, check it out. It's such an innovation for that industry now that's looking to be replicated and copied around the world. So that's another Canadian first to be able to promote electric vehicle production. Bruce Power, we've looked at our rural area and have installed charging stations throughout many of the towns. First, to start the introduction of the charging station, because we don't have the population density in our neck of the woods, as they say. Maybe in the cities. But nonetheless, they're starting to be used, and we just installed some new ones at the Bruce site now, and you can see cars pulling up to them regularly.
Okay.
I would add that I think your point is well taken. If you can decarbonize the electric generating sector, as has largely been done in Ontario to a large extent in New Brunswick, you can take that and use that to decarbonize other sectors of the economy through efficient electrification. That's transportation, but it's more than transportation. And that is a primary pathway to greenhouse gas reduction. And I would point out that in Ontario last year, we spilled 10 terawatt hours of greenhouse gas-free energy that comes with almost zero incremental cost. So there's already a huge amount of low-cost greenhouse gas-free energy that can be used to efficiently electrify the economy with the right set of systems and controls.
Okay. We have time for two or three more questions. So there's one person over here. There's a person up near the front here. Let's go there first.
Hi, Patrick Yates from Lambton College. My question is more specifically for OPG. With the coal plants being phased out and these monster plants sitting there in this valuable land, is there any plan to use that land for SMRs or a solar farm?
The answer is yes. We are in the process. We've retired our last coal, so they're all shut down. We're in the process right now of decommissioning and dismantling those facilities. As a matter of fact, in just a few days, we'll implode the old stacks at Nanticoke. So those two giant stacks will come crashing down. And there at Nanticoke, we're currently building a 45 megawatt solar facility on the location of the old coal pile. These are very valuable sites for us because they have access to water. They already are well understood environmentally and geologically. They're tied into the transmission system. Those communities are comfortable with generating facilities. And so those sites are prime opportunities for the next generation of electrical production, including SMRs. We have a license to construct at our Darlington facility, issued by Dr. Binder and the CNSC, that we can act on when the time is right, as an example.
Okay. We've got someone right near the front here.
My name is John Hilborn, and I'm definitely of the older generation. My first job was at the Port Radium Uranium Mine, Northwest Territories, in 1949. And I'm still very actively involved in the industry. Next month, on March the 31st, our venerable NRU reactor is to be shut down, and it's intended to be a permanent shutdown. This is forever. So we'll be the only nuclear power country that does not have a research reactor. And my question to you is, what is your personal opinion on this shutdown? And I'll just add that from that date onwards, Canada will be importing most of the nuclear medicine isotopes, most of the medical isotopes that are required in the hospitals. And that means that Canada will no longer have control over price or availability for the indefinite future. So I'd like your personal opinions, not necessarily your company opinions, but what do you feel about it?
Okay. Thank you. Who wants to go first?
Yeah, I will. I spent a lot of my career working with different universities that have had reactors, and some have had elected to close them over time because of age or other things. But what you end up seeing happening is it really suffers, and it starts in academia. Right, because without resources like that, advances in things like material science get pushed away. Advances in medicine get pushed away. The reactors enable a whole other level of looking at, I'll say, materials and other properties that you just can't do without that source being available. So it is a loss, in my opinion, not only for this industry, but for the healthcare industry, the automotive industry, the airline industry, right, and on and on and on. Having those types of facilities available in an economy, I can really talk about that from terms of innovation and the pursuit of new ideas. Right, not having that resource starts to close the door on that approach, on those approaches into the future. So I think it's a real loss. It's a real loss not to have a high quality research facility.
Okay.
I totally agree. I think there was a time because of the issues with the industry, and part of it we have to take accountability. We did not deliver, you know, some of these projects, but the vision has been lost, a tremendous loss, in my view, and we're going to go together, and we're going to try to resurrect this vision of a growing nuclear country, and somehow there's got to be some plans, because to be at the mercy of the world for something that is so essential for academia, innovation, medical requirement, it wasn't a great visionary who made the decision to shut it down. I mean, and maybe it had to shut down. Like, there's a financial impact. But somehow you have to have, when you shut something down in the utility, we have to come up with an alternate plan to keep it going.
I think you picked the right word there, vision or loss of vision.
Yeah.
So there's the impact of the shutdown at NRU. But what's really striking to me is a country with a history of innovating, creating its own reactor designs, deploying them, all the success that's here. For a country like that, not to be able to turn its national lab forward, look to the future, and be on the cutting edge of developing all those technologies, that's a problem. And Mark Lisinski's going to talk a bit. But for me, it's less about shutting down the reactor and more about Canada creating a nuclear policy and a nuclear vision and putting CNL at the forefront of that to drive innovation and technology development, whether that's Gen 4 reactors, molten salt, very small reactors, modular reactors that can be used in remote communities. This is an important piece of the puzzle that we shouldn't let slip away.
And I think it's a social issue as well. When we talk about Cobalt 60, Canada has 80% of the world market share. We invented the technology for treatment of brain tumors. We powered that as a result of that reactor over the years and came up with a treatment of brain tumors such that it didn't impact the brain other than within 1 millimeter of the beam. Is it responsible, is it right to abdicate that leadership to others? And I think that's a question that really needs to be asked on a broader scale. If not Canada to lead, then who does, right? Who will? And who will provide that resource at a price that can be affordable?
And it's not okay. Too late.
No.
It's not too late, right? That's
correct.
What you said.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
I agree.
I want to thank Jeff, Gaetan, and Mike for their insights, their thoughtful comments, and their passion for the future of this industry. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts today.
Thank you.